From CNBC, a senator is introducing a bill that would blow up the business models for Facebook, YouTube, and other tech giants, and that is a terrible headline because that is absolutely not what is happening. We can see for some reason there are many people in media who want to run to the defense of these big tech companies. Don't ask me why. In my opinion, they are out of control, stealing our private data, doing really bad things behind closed doors, all for profit. It's causing massive damage to public discourse. Yet time and time again, we see people in media rushing to their defense, even though the New York Times has complained that Google has destroyed local journalism and has made billions off of their backs. The story we have today, Senator Josh Hawley is introducing legislation that will put restrictions on Section 230 protections. For those that aren't familiar, Section 230 essentially provides immunity to an online platform from liability based on what someone says on their site. Though it is really complicated, but it basically works like this. If I own, say, the Wall Street Journal, and I publish something on the front page, you can sue the Wall Street Journal for that. They've chosen to make a statement. However, in their comments section, they're not responsible. So when it comes to Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, etc., you can't sue YouTube because I say something. You have to come to me. They're not liable for that, for those issues. A lot of people are confusing Section 230 with a First Amendment defense. Admittedly, I've done something similar in the past, but there is an interesting argument. Section 230 grants immunity to these companies under the premise that they are platforms. That's the rhetoric. I'm not sure if that's legally what they're saying, but the idea is if AT&T, a phone company, were to remove people based on what they were saying, that's a serious violation and they're not a platform. They're a publisher. They're taking an editorial stance. So a lot of people view Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, Google, whatever, as a phone company. But these companies like to have it both ways. They like to simultaneously argue that they are not the speaker. And this is where it's important. We'll go to the law in a second. Section 230 says that a website will not be deemed to be the speaker of that content. If they're legally removed from that, why are these companies using a First Amendment argument to take down content? Their argument is that they can remove anything they want because they have no legal obligation to speak. And that's a First Amendment argument. I agree. But I also think regulation exists for a reason, and that when companies grow too large, something needs to be done about it. So here's what we're going to do. Let's read through this story and figure out what the hell's going on. And I've got some really interesting quotes, because I'll tell you what. These tech giants have flat out said they refute protected First Amendment speech. And this is a mind-blowing comment they've given in response to this story. I'll tell you what, man. I warned the Twitter people on the Joe Rogan podcast, regulation will come. And they were like, well, you know, we know what they like and we know what we can do. No, you don't. I was right. And this is not the first time, nor will it be the last time. Before we get started, head over to timcast.com/donate if you'd like to support my work, because once again, we're talking about censorship. And of course, I'm directly criticizing the companies on which platform, on whose platform I am using. So, you know, as a PayPal option, as a crypto option, a physical address. But of course, so long as they don't, you know, I guess, remove me at some point, like, comment, share, and subscribe, because for the time being, I'm producing content here. From CNBC, they say, Senator Josh Hawley, Republican, is turning up the heat on an issue that is sure to spark outrage in Silicon Valley. He's a well-known tech critic, and he introduced legislation on Wednesday that would remove the immunity big technology companies receive under Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act of 1996. The CDA protects online platforms such as Facebook, Twitter, and Google's YouTube from liability for the content users post. However, companies will be able to earn immunity from the crackdown if they submit to biannual audits to prove their algorithms and content removal practices are politically neutral, which they absolutely will not be able to do because hate speech rules are not politically neutral. It would mean they'd have to remove those. But wait until you see the statement they issued where they said they do not want protected First Amendment speech on their platforms, which we'll get to in just a second. The idea of limiting Section 230 immunity has earned bipartisan support in recent years as the companies have struggled to keep offensive and illegal content ranging from propaganda to foreign-influenced election meddling off their platforms. Repealing the immunity provision could force these companies to use an editorial system where every piece of user-posted content would have to be vetted for illegal or libelous material before it's posted, instead relying on algorithms and human checkers to scan it after it was already online and had a chance to spread to millions of people. This is a terrible article, I want to say. No, it won't do this. This would fundamentally alter the business models of companies that depend on huge volumes of user-generated content, including all the big social networks. What the law would do is one of two things. The argument being put forward is that either you are neutral in your enforcement of certain rules, or you are liable for what people say, as it should already be. Repealing the immunity provision could force that, sure. What this could also do, this law specifically, is force these companies to recognize legally protected speech, things they personally don't like, but who elected them to determine what we're allowed to talk about anyway? The provision, the law would put a restriction based on the size and revenue of the company, so it wouldn't affect smaller networks, which is a good idea. You don't want to put constraints on smaller businesses, but these big tech giants have a disproportionate amount of influence over public discourse and, yes, the economy. So it's about time the public reclaimed that portion of the commons to a certain degree, I would argue. And it's going to happen. Listen, it's not about left, right, top down. They mention in the story it's got bipartisan support. There are people on the left who are outraged at the censorship. They're waking up to it. They're late to the party, I got to say. But the Electronic Frontier Foundation recently launched something called Tossed Out, which is a reference to TOS Terms of Service, where they said these rules are arbitrarily taking out activists. They are. Plain and simple. Legally protected speech, regardless of left, right, center, top down, whatever, should be allowed. How you enforce it, we're going to have to figure it out, but it needs to be protected. let me read a little bit more. They say Hawley's bill, the Ending Support for Internet Censorship Act, would maintain immunity for small and medium-sized companies, only companies with more than 30 million active monthly users in the U.S., more than 300 million active monthly users worldwide, and more than $500 million in global annual revenue would have to comply. However, these companies could earn immunity through external audits, wherein they would have to prove to the Federal Trade Commission that their algorithms and content removal practices are politically neutral. Immunity certification would require a supermajority vote by the FTC. Companies would have to reapply every 2 years. Listen, I don't see how you could actually prove you're politically neutral. That seems to be absurdly complicated. They would have to basically just revert the sites to legal speech, period. You can't argue they're politically biased if they allow anything that's legal. But guess what? That will result in a lot of awful things people would be saying. But hey, welcome to the real world. The story says proponents of maintaining Section 230 immunity argue that it does not only protect tech companies. The Electronic Frontier Foundation has argued that it also protects traditional media companies for liability for comments that users post on their websites, for instance. Yes. But the comment section of, say, CNN.com are not going to exceed 300 million monthly global users or whatever. I really, really doubt it. Unique users. So they go on to say that in April, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi told Recode's Kara Swisher that Section 230 is a gift to them, and I don't think they are treating it with the respect that they should, and so I think that could be a question mark in jeopardy. These comments came before outrage over videos of Pelosi giving a speech in May were doctored to make her seem intoxicated. Videos that Facebook and Twitter refused to remove. Now, I assure you, under any regulation, which can only ratchet in one direction because of the First Amendment, they would absolutely allow more videos like that, Nancy Pelosi. Interestingly, a lot of people on the left are arguing for regulation to prevent speech, but the government can't do that. What do you think the tech giants had to say? In this quote, Michael Beckerman, this is the Internet Association president, said, CDA 230 is the law that allows online companies to moderate and remove content that no reasonable person wants online, including content that could have a, quote, political viewpoint. The bill forces platforms to make an impossible choice, either host reprehensible but First Amendment protected speech or lose legal protections that allow them to moderate illegal content like human trafficking and violent extremism. That shouldn't be a trade-off. And guess what? That wouldn't be allowed, you duplicitous liar. I can't stand how these people lie and tug at your heartstrings about illegal activity, which is not protected and would be removed. You can't threaten someone or admit to a crime or commit a crime. You can't, like, there are laws about transmitting malicious messages, threatening people, etc. This is a duplicitous manipulation to try and give them personal political protections. No. Internet companies share Senator Hawley's goal of ensuring online platforms are somewhere individuals can freely and safely share their views. Not true. We've heard it from Jack Dorsey. He wants his personal view of healthy conversations. I can respect that. but I don't agree with your opinions. So why should you, an unelected billionaire, have the right to restrict what citizens have a right to say in this country? You have a disproportionate amount of control on what we're allowed to do and say in the economy, and it's time for some regulation. Notice how they always try to claim that someone presenting First Amendment speech is reprehensible and then immediately jumps to the most extreme of human trafficking. Is that a joke? That's a joke, isn't it? Because that is not what anyone is arguing. We're arguing that someone has a right to their opinion to say something like, I dislike X. There have been people like Megan Murphy banned. She was first suspended from Twitter for saying men aren't women, though. That's the kind of thing that's being removed. That is not, that's arguably reprehensible to some people and not to others. To others, it's considered true. Why should you have the right? Who elected you? No one. And no, that statement from Megan Murphy is in no way similar to trafficking. So interestingly, there's another a statement made by General Counsel for NetChoice, and they try to play the same exact game. Carl Szabo, General Counsel for NetChoice, another tech industry group, said the bill would turn popular sites into hubs for extremism. I don't entirely disagree. This is from KansasCity.com. It wouldn't turn them into hubs necessarily, but it absolutely would protect pretty ridiculous speech. Senator Hawley's bill creates an internet where content from the Klan would display alongside our family photos and cat videos. Full stop. Once again, these companies are hell-bent on lying to you. Section 230 would not prevent Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube from restricting algorithmic promotion. Period. On Twitter's timeline mode, if you choose to follow someone, if someone chooses to retweet, yes, you will see that content. But you can choose to block it. On Facebook, there is no obligation of Facebook to promote algorithmically this content. They are conflating or just completely ignorant to what is actually going on these platforms and what these regulations will do. On YouTube, there is no right to algorithmic recommendation or monetization. But there is a principle that if they're going to welcome the public to speak, your legally protected speech should remain without suppression or removal. YouTube engages in what's called a limited state restriction. They find legal speech that is borderline, as they call it. This is content that doesn't violate their rules, and they remove all ability to share, search, comment, etc. That is suppression. No one is asking YouTube, Twitter, or Facebook to promote to their front page. That is absurd. This content would never appear next to your family photos unless you elect for it to appear. We're talking about the right for American citizens and, to a certain extent, other citizens of the world to engage in legally protected speech. Yes, that can be hateful. I don't like that either. But I don't like you being the arbiter of fact, truth, and health in the conversation. So I'm not the only one who thinks so. Congressman Paul Gosar and Matt Gaetz have called for the removing Article 1917 from the USMCA. This is essentially an international version of Section 230, which is part of the new trade agreement that Trump proposed. This article from Forbes just last week says, to protect free speech, reform Section 230, don't put it into the USMCA. Matt Gaetz has been a strong critic of Section 230 and how these tech companies manipulate and flaunt the use of this immunity, this protection. I did a story a while ago, and I don't have the sources pulled up, so I'm going to say it's my understanding. Without the sources pulled up, I don't want to act like it's definitive. But I've covered various stories where Facebook simultaneously argues it is a publisher akin to the New York Times, and other times it argues it's a platform. When they argue they're a platform, they're doing it to say, you can't hold us responsible because we just platform. We don't choose. However, they refused access to certain companies, which is essentially, it's monopolistic in a sense. This is my understanding. I could be wrong. How I remember the story, they refused access to certain companies and claimed, well, we're a publisher. We can choose who appears on our platform. You can't do both. I'm not sure if there's a legal distinction between the two, but we can see what they're trying to do. They're trying to flaunt the law to get it both ways. Pick one. You're like the phone company or you're like a newspaper. In reality, they're like the phone company. But they don't want to play these games. Unfortunately, these are the rules, and it's about time we got some enforcement. This writer, Adam Kandub, a contributor for Forbes, says, in an effort to justify the giveaway, which is Section 230, big tech's defenders claim that Article 1917 and Section 230 itself protect free speech. This claim could not be further from the truth. In reality, Section 230 protects big tech censorship. In the U.S., reforming the law is the first step. In the U.S., reforming the law is the first step to restoring the free flow of ideas online and expanding the reach of its principles through the U.S. EMCA is but pure. Expanding its reach to the EMCA is pure folly. Congress passed Section 230 with two main provisions, each with a different purpose. First, online platforms cannot be treated as the publisher or speaker of any information provided by another. In other words, Facebook cannot be held liable for defamatory, tortious, or otherwise illegal content which its users post. Here, Congress wanted to protect upstart internet companies by limiting their potential huge liability for every statement posted on their platforms. By relieving them of liability resulting from user-generated content, Congress gave the early internet firms the same protections as a newsstand, library, and other distributors received under common law for the content they distributed via print. Second, a Good Samaritan provision immunizes platforms for restricting content that they believe in good faith to be obscene, lewd, lascivious, filthy, excessively violent, harassing, or otherwise objectionable, whether or not such material is constitutionally protected. This provision aims to remove disincentives from filtering out obscene and violent content. Congress passed this provision in reaction to previous judicial rulings. Some courts had ruled that efforts by internet platforms to censor and remove obscene content rendered them liable for all user-generated content. Thus, the Good Samaritan exception allows such limited censorship while still giving the platforms immunity for all other types of user-generated content. However, he goes on to say, over the last two decades, some courts have broadly interpreted Section 230 to give platforms total immunity for any tortious or illegal content, and even allow them to disobey takedown orders issued by courts after formal legal judgments. Silicon Valley has had less luck in using the Good Samaritan provision to grant themselves an unrestricted right to censor. Courts have generally held that it only grants immunity for removals made in good faith and have declined to broadly interpret otherwise objectionable material to include any or all information or content, as the Southern District of California held in Sherman v. Yahoo 2014. As Google and Facebook have become indispensable intermediaries for online speech, they have also increasingly used their power to censor views they disagree with. While they start off with obnoxious trolls and the fringe right, they have gradually gone after more and more mainstream conservative voices, and even some liberals and moderates who offend their sensibilities. In this, they eviscerate their public promises to be free platforms open to all ideas, and they often use Section 230 to defend themselves against suits challenging their failure to live up to their promises. He goes on, but I don't want to necessarily just read the argument from Forbes here. I want to end with two very important points. This is a story from Real Clear Politics, which apparently, there we go. Rep. Matt Gaetz to Twitter. This is from July of last year. You tell Congress one thing, but in court, your lawyer says something different. In his testimony, he says, what I want to understand is, if you say I enjoy rights under the First Amendment and I'm covered by Section 230, and Section 230 itself says, quote, no provider shall be considered the speaker, do you see the tension that creates? The issue here is that Twitter has argued under the First Amendment they cannot be compelled to host the speech of someone they don't like. But if Twitter itself considers itself to be the speaker under the First Amendment argument, but Section 230 only protects them insofar as they're not the speaker, they're taking it both ways. You can't do that. I'll say this. It's an extremely complicated problem. I don't know what the right regulation is. I don't know what we should or shouldn't do. But I'll tell you this. These companies have regulation coming. We need something. We cannot let them control public discourse through some international norm they arbitrarily decide and then remove the legal speech of American citizens from public discourse. We are in a world right now where Twitter, Facebook, and Google recognize Russian interference played a role in the 2016 election. That means foreign citizens know how to manipulate our platforms to cause division in our country, yet the legally protected speech of our own citizens is restricted under their rules. Why should we allow foreign actors to lie, cheat, and steal, but then some conservative in, I don't know, the panhandle of Oklahoma can't send out a tweet about how they feel about what the president is doing because it runs afoul of arbitrary rules? We cannot have that as a standard, at least in my opinion. And that brings me to a political example from just the other day. Vox, V-O-X, it's considered a far-right party in Spain. I'm not super familiar with who they are or what they want, nor do I particularly care in this context. It's probably important to know who they are and what they want in other contexts. The point here is, Vox is a growing and prominent political faction. You may not like them. Fine. They said in a tweet, YouTube removes the Vox channel without explanation. The decision to remove the channel is a serious attack on the freedom of expression and dissemination of a political party. YouTube Espanol, we require an explanation and that the account be enabled as soon as possible. Apparently it had to do with copyright. I'm not entirely sure, but I'll say this. Would you want to live in a world where corporations can arbitrarily excise public speech? Let me make one thing clear for all the people on the left, especially those who oppose the Citizens United ruling. There is an anger among many people on the left that super PACs were essentially brought into existence under the Citizens United ruling, which says individuals can donate effectively endless amounts of money to super PACs, unrelated political action committees that don't coordinate with the politicians because essentially the money is speech, corporations are people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's complicated. Let me ask you this. If you don't like the idea of corporations being people, if you don't like the idea of massive international corporations with billions of dollars putting a disproportionate amount of weight on public discourse to shut down legal speech, why would you stand by and watch YouTube, Google, Twitter, Facebook do just that? It's confusing to me. I don't know. But I'll end with bringing it back to the main point. Regulation is coming. There is bipartisan support. And Josh Hawley's bill is just the latest. There have been several state-level bills that have been presented. My understanding is they're in flux right now. Some have failed. Some are still going through the process. But I assure you, regulation is coming. Facebook knows it. They've been hiring antitrust lawyers. There's been antitrust regulation looming for Google. Whether or not this will impact speech is yet to be seen. But the regulation investigations, I'm saying, in terms of legislation, you better damn well believe Republicans are seeing what's happening. The story with Pinterest, James O'Keefe's expose, a whistleblower from Pinterest. Pinterest came out and said they are censoring certain voices. It is political, entirely political. And in response to that video, my comment on it on YouTube was taken down. Now, that is some dangerous precedent for journalism and our culture and our country, that YouTube would remove my commentary on public information because it offended the sensibilities of Pinterest. Who gave Pinterest that right? Regulation is coming, and they better damn well believe it. And naturally, they're outraged. Thanks for hanging out. Stick around. I got more videos coming up. YouTube.com/TimCastNews starting at 6 p.m. And for those on the podcast, this all will be up around 6:30 every day. Thanks for hanging out. I will see you in the next story.